Hi folks, and welcome back to the workshop. Last time you saw the Land Rover on film was the Amberley Classic Land Rover Day. Really good day actually, good atmosphere at the museum and some interesting Land Rovers. WRD up until then had been going really well. On the way home she started to suffer a pretty serious transmission vibration. About 10 miles from home it got really bad and I just nursed it home. And it's been parked up ever since. It's actually had this issue for a while, intermittently under acceleration. Sometimes you could drive it all week and it wouldn't do it. And then you'd go somewhere else and it would do it every time you accelerated in top gear. And you could lift off and get out of it, but it was really annoying. So anyway, it worsened on the way home from that day out. It's been parked up ever since. And now's the moment to fit the new transmission. I've got about 65,000 miles out of the one that I fitted, which was really just a bits are made from series 3 and 2A bits and pieces. They're pretty well worn when I got it, and it didn't have anything like as an extensive rebuild as this one has, so I think I've done pretty well with it. Hopefully this one will last a lot longer. I just spent a bit of time over the last couple of weekends going through things like some of the missing fixings that I hadn't quite finished off. So like the studs on the back of the speedometer housing there. And just making sure it's going to work with the 2.5 petrol engine, flywheel and housing assembly. I think I've worked out what I've got to do there. But we'll go into that another time. So anyway, there we are. They're basically ready to fit. Just always stripping out the interior. It's come out all very easily so far. Just take a note of where some of the floor screws are and we'll start taking the floor up next. And then working my way around the seat box fixings. Some of which unfortunately are going to be difficult to access because of the modifications to my vehicle. I'm hoping I can undo the fixings and then just pull the seat box forward and not have to remove the winch. This was the Gearbox dipstick and fuller I made up for this one. There we go, managed to get all the seat box bolts out. A whole lot, all the floor bolts. Basically the seat box is now ready to lift out. So I'm going to try and chip away at this over the week, drain the boxes down, disconnect a few more bits like the handbrake. And then hopefully next weekend, pull the gearbox out. Just drained the gear oil, it's pretty bronzy. It's only done a few thousand miles in this gearbox. But there are quite a few chunks in it. I think that is from the front end of the lay shaft where the driving gear goes on that engages with the primary pinion. There's a sort of radius like that, so I have a feeling something's happened there. The box was quite noisy at idle. When you started the car from cold you could hear it. It was a sort of bearing noise, so something's happened. Probably the lay shaft bolt has dropped out. That's a very common series 3 issue, and what actually killed the previous gearbox. Yeah, chunky gear oil, never good. The seat box came out quite easily. I was really hoping not to have to take that fuel tank out because that's a bit of a pain, but as it happened, quite easy. We can actually see a few of the modifications to my vehicle now more easily. We've got a winch for the load bay for loading the stationary engines. You'll note the thick spreader plate is mounted on. There's one underneath as well, and that works very well. You'll note the gearbox dipstick and fuller series 1 style, again they work very well. The Roma drive, of course, just about the best thing you can buy provided the gearbox is in good shape. I've had this one a few years now and it's been brilliant. Also got an extra support for the front downpipe on the exhaust system, which works fantastically. It stops the manifold bolts coming loose. Very simple, and it's like a midsection clamp that I've used there, and just a twisted stainless steel bracket that I made. One thing I wish I had done was specified the gearbox crossmember. I wouldn't have had to have the seat box out, really. And obviously the long range fuel tank and changeover valve. While we're here, we've got to sort out a leaking fuel sender. The new fuel sender is bubbling fuel up all the time. Really annoying. So I'm just going to fit a blanking plate. And I know I can get well over 100 miles on that tank, so I tend to drive 100 miles on that and change over if I'm on a long run. Nice to be able to have a look at the outriggers and so on. It's all in good shape. And the body tub isn't too bad. The usual little bit of corrosion, but I've been keeping an eye on it and treating it over the years. So it's not a showroom condition vehicle by any stretch, but it's not too bad. So the next thing is, now I've removed the handbrake assembly, we need to get the rest of it out of the way. Take the bottom off the transfer box. It's draining at the moment. I've just cracked the cover open. And remove the brake backplate there. We can then remove the overdrive, then the intermediate gear from the transfer box, and then remove the transfer box from the gearbox. Of course, before we do all that, we actually need to jack the back end up, and you can just see the crossmember below the gearbox bell housing. We need to put a wooden chock in there.
Should be about an inch gap there. It's about half an inch, which gives some idea of how badly sagged the mounts are. The transmission was bouncing up and down quite well when you were driving at speed.
Go down pretty well at the bottom off the transfer case now. The brake bits are off, the overdrive, none of that posed any difficulties. So now I'm going to get under there and loosen the two bolts on each mount. And then probably that exhaust strap as well, and think about jacking up the back of the transfer box, getting my wooden wedge in, because it'll sit there under its own weight for the minute. But I'm about at the point, once I've done that, where I can then work my way around those bolts and hopefully separate the transfer case from the main box. But now I'm stuck in it. Twist it round. Right, so what I think we're going to do is leave this backwards, and then I'm going to try and rest it on the gearbox crossmember, then lift it out. I'm going to take the inspection plate off, and then I can use the inspection hole there as a handhold if I can get the cover off. This was all very well planned, just yeah. Oh.
pretty normal.
There's nothing immediately apparent. I'm amazed that the little anti-rattle staple has stayed in there. Obviously a new release bearing was fitted when the chassis was done, so that's nice, but it's always felt a bit spongy. The top of the clutch pedal travel has felt a bit spongy, and that bearing has come unstuck from the plastic carrier, which is interesting. I've got all the wearing parts for that, so it's not an issue. But I suspect the trouble will be behind that black cover. Just behind there is the low shaft bolt, and I'll bet that that's come loose, and it's not too difficult to have a look either. A little bit of gear oil in there, but not a lot of engine oil. I was expecting it to be much worse. This was last apart in 2019, I think. I appreciate the lights fading. I'm probably going to finish up here today. So yeah, you probably can't see a lot, but notice it's a clutch fix clutch. I was really expecting a Britpart one. Most garages, because I had the chassis change done by a garage, would use the cheaper parts, but they haven't. So that's nice to see. Yeah, so all in all, it's quite a lot better than what I was expecting. And it's not all full of oil, of course. I had the remain seal done at the same time. A little bit of oil in there, but kind of part of it with the Land Rover. Well, it's well dark now, but I've managed to get all this into the workshop. So I just thought I'd have a quick look in the gearbox, see what it's like in there. See if I can see any obvious breakages. I might whip the bell housing off tonight. Kind of curious to see what's gone wrong. Anyway, a couple of things. First of all, you can see the later type selector seals, which work a treat. The two-piece seals, if you look in the parts book, you'll find them. That's the factory parts book. And that is a very worthwhile conversion. It does keep things much drier under your Land Rover. Second thing is I've taken all the selector detents out. So when you take the top cover off, it's a classic rookie error to lose the ball bearings and detents into the gearbox. Not the end of the world, you can usually get them out pretty easy. And you can see the different selector springs. So the reverse one over here is shorter. These two are the same, the top one and the one on the near side. So I now need to get this coupling off the back of the gearbox. Normally you'd have a gear on there, but I've got a Roma drive, so you have this splined coupling. Interesting that this has actually managed to work loose. Probably can't see, but nothing's turning while I'm doing that. However, when I put this on, because it had come loose before, as the nut on the back of the gearbox always seems to, I used a blue Loctite, sort of semi-permanent one, on the grub screws, and I used a retaining compound on the nut itself, and then torqued it to about 120 foot-pound, I think, which is somewhat over what you should torque them to, but that was after having trouble. Anyway, so I've heated it up, because Loctite will release with heat, got the grub screws out, and I'm now just going to have a go and see if I can get the nut undone. I suspect not. I suspect I'll have to strap this down to something and get a breaker bar on it. Anyway, to do that you need to lock the gearbox, as I've done. So you see it's locked up. And what you do is you engage third and reverse. So this is the third fourth gear selector, and that backwards is third gear. And likewise, this is the reverse selector backwards. And that gives a full lockup. I'm intending to do this with the other gearbox, the new one, and put the coupling on so that it all goes back in much the same way. It's a bit easier than what I did last time. Well, it was so well on there, I ratchet strapped it to the workbench leg, and that allowed me to get the breaker bar on it. Bit of heat and it came undone. Yeah, the couplings run loose again, like how I found it a year ago. And it has chipped the splines a bit more, but only at the very back. It's quite serviceable still, so we'll clean it up. I might obtain a spare one of those one day, but I imagine they're not cheap. You get a socket supplied with the Roma drive. It's a deep 27mm socket. The nut, which is probably still quite hot, has got the grub screws bearing on this diameter here. It's quite a neat idea, but nothing seems to quite work with these gearboxes. They seem to always shake the main shaft nut loose. Very antiquated design. It goes back to a pre-war Rover car. It's not a lot different really, other than of course these ones are supposed to be full synchromesh. In reality, first and second synchromesh is pretty weak. Well, I thought today I'd start cleaning up some of the bits and pieces that I'll need. I needed to strip off things like the clutch release mechanism and transfer that onto the new gearbox. But I thought before I do, I'd just investigate the actual cause of failure. I'd really like to know. So I was expecting to see trouble at the front of the lay shaft. I took the front cover off from inside the bell housing, and the only thing evident in there is a bit of bronzy deposit, but it's not really very unusual. All the clutch release kit is quite nice, apart from the slave cylinder, which is fine except for the fact that the little rubber boot is swelled up by like 10%. But anyway, it's fine inside. That would actually go again if I wanted it to. So it's nice to see that's all fared well. I was expecting to see the lay shelf bolt hanging out, which is a very common failure, but it's not even loose. The play in the input shaft bearing is normal. Obviously a bit of wear in that bearing, but that's nothing unusual. So I think we've got to undo the lay shelf bolt and take the bell housing off. That's the next thing. I get the feeling this is going to end up in bits on the workshop floor very quickly. I've just popped the bell housing off. Nothing wrong in there. It looks pretty good. The problems are just where we thought they were going to be. So if I take this spacer off, I'll come back to that in a minute. That's important. And that gear, you can see that there's some splines missing, or the shoulder that should be on those splines is missing. Now, when I first, well, when I rebuilt this was the first gearbox I rebuilt, and all I had was the Haynes manual, which tells you pretty much everything you need to know, but it doesn't tell you that these spacers come in different sizes. And if we pop that back on there, you can see there's a kind of, a stain about 1/8 inch up from the collar. And that's where the bearing stops. Now, of course, the bearing's got a bit of a radius in its bore, so that line won't be exactly where the spacer is, even if it was the right size. But basically, what's been happening, I think, is that the spacer was inadequate, so the spacer and gear have been floating back and forth a bit on the lay shaft, which of course, being a helical gear, every time it comes under drive and then onto the overrun, it will bump back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. So eventually it's busted those splines. Now that was something I took a great deal of care over to get right with the new box, so it shouldn't be an issue. Because having got hold of the proper workshop manual, I knew I'd not done it. Not really evident looking at the gear teeth what's been happening, but I think that is probably the case. You can see almost like impact marks on the back there, so that's probably what's done it. I think I'm going to pull both of them shafts out of there and just see if there's anything else wrong, because the vibration was quite severe and I almost find it difficult to believe that that's just the cause of it. Well, here's another issue. The main shaft rear bearing housing is loose. if you watch the series on the rebuild of the gearbox that's going back in, the original one, you'll notice I pointed out someone had drilled a hole about there and pegged the circlip to try and stop the bearing housing spinning. You install these with Loctite. I remember this one wasn't a brilliant fit at the time, but I kind of had no other option, so I used it. I was an apprentice at the time, so on a serious budget with the parts I could use for this. But yeah, it's not brilliant. There were a couple of things happening. The transfer box oil level was topping up, so it was probably passing a bit through there over time. And yeah, I should think that would have developed a bit of end float as well, so a bit of noise all round. I shouldn't think it was spinning very hard, but under load, yeah, you can see it has been for some time. That shouldn't be happening. And as I say, you do install those with Loctite retaining compound, so at least we'll have no trouble getting that out. So it's just turned into a full autopsy. I think this will get rebuilt and I'll either keep it as a spare or sell it, but we'll do it properly. It's probably worth doing these days. There were a few things that I learnt with this. It was the first one I did, as I say, and I've done a few since, including the one that's been fitted. One of the troubles I had when I got this in the vehicle was that the gear change, third, fourth, was quite heavy. You really had to be quite forceful with it to get it into gear, and it would change quietly, no problem with the synchros. But the problem was the synchronizer hub was actually hanging up on its splines. And what it is that some of these new main shafts are made, albeit quite a good quality, the inner splines are not cut quite deep enough. And if you look at this,
you might just be able to catch almost like a diamond pattern where over time the machining marks or inclusions have been honed off.
And it took a long time for the gear change to free up and become really nice and smooth. And I must say, it was quite nice. Had a nice feel to it, especially for an old Land Rover. You know, they don't have to be shonky. But I had exactly the same issue when I got the bits to build the new gearbox, which is going in. The synchronizer hub would not fit on the new main shaft. So I carefully measured it and determined that once again the inner splines were just a bit too large, and so I very carefully honed off the machining marks with a stone, let the supplier know I'd had trouble with it, so you know, hopefully they're doing something about it. But anyway, I ended up with a nice free synchronizer hub like that. They need to be free. Immediately noticeable with this is there's a bit of play in the gear there. It's on a bronze bush. Not so bad, that one. The first set in gear synchronizer has always been pretty useless on this box, right from the off. I remember when I got it new, the unit there was assembled backwards, but I was never very happy with that. And yeah, synchros on first and second, pretty much useless. You should really be able to just drive these gearboxes using the synchros, but I've always had to double clutch and rev match, which is something I do anyway, but you shouldn't have to. It should be the case with the new gearbox that I can just drive it. This is a Suffix B gearbox, early series 3, and yeah, they're known for being a little weak, synchros first and second particularly. But even so, I was never happy with it. So, as I say, I learnt lots building this gearbox. But it's, you know, it was a daily driver for a long time. It's carried me many, many miles to lots of interesting places. I can't grumble. I'm going to take that clip off there, have that apart, and we'll see what's really going on. If I remember rightly, I fitted the two-part main shaft bush. Land Rover famously couldn't stop the main shaft bushes splitting in two, so the remedy was to supply a two-part one in the first place. Kind of amusing, but yeah, let's have a look. So as I say, this is a two-part main shaft bush, so normally there would be a it's like a double top bush, that bit in the middle, bronze bush that side and another that side. But you can see this one's in two bits. In the new box I've actually fitted a one part bronze bush, but gone to a bit of trouble to make sure it's got proper running in lubricant around it. Anyway, the bronze bush is hung up in third gear, which is a very common issue and why they used to shear off. And you know, like towing with Land Rovers, if you were towing a heavy trailer you'd probably spend quite a lot of time in third gear, dragging up hills and so on. And that's the kind of time you're likely to have that failure. I can just push that back and forth, but it basically it has seized in the shaft. So instead of the gear rotating around the bush, the bronze bush has been rotating on the shaft, hence the marks you can see. And hence it's been chewing on those splines a bit, and then developed quite a bit of free play. And that's quite bad actually. So I wouldn't wonder if that was some of the vibration we were seeing. You think obviously this is running at engine speed when in top gear. In third it was vibrating quite badly at higher revs, so that figures really. Yeah, it's a bit worse than I thought it might be. But to be fair, it's done quite well. It's in somewhat better condition than what I expected to find. Some of these gears were new, I think this might have been a reused one, can't remember now. They weren't perfect, but they were pretty good. And the bronze bush is nice and free in that one, and also pegged, you'll note the peg's still there, which again is quite unusual. Again, they tend to chew them and spit them out. Another common failure, these are not brilliant gearboxes. Now, just cleaned up and degreased all the gearbox parts, ready to store away for rebuild, and all the clutch bits that I need. The clutch cylinder will actually go again, nothing really wrong with it. I'm going to replace it, but I'll make sure I clean this up, assemble it with a bit of red rubber grease and put it aside as a spare. Well, that's going to be it for today. I've cleaned up all the bits and pieces. Pouring with rain today, so it's been quite nice. It's worked well, got everything done I wanted to yesterday, and I think I've done everything that I wanted to today. It doesn't happen very often. It's quite pleased that the Roma drive coupling came off all right. That I imagine would be an expensive bit to replace. Got a choice of intermediate gears there. One looks better than the other potentially, so we'll make a decision on that. And I've got the clutch bits and pieces to assemble onto the gearbox. So some little assembly jobs that I can do on the dark evenings this week, and potentially next weekend actually get the gearbox in, which would be nice. Anyway, hope you've enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching.